It's a beautiful day. All is calm and peaceful in the meadow. Or is it?
The film Watership Down was not released in the 1980s, nor is it really a fantasy movie. The movie focuses on a group of rabbits who decide to leave their warren in search of a safe place to exist after one rabbit, Fiver, has a premonition that their warren is going to be destroyed. It is made explicitly clear in the opening scene of the movie, which recounts the myth of Prince Elarara, that rabbits were made in divine creation to be eternally hunted and haunted due to the wrongdoings of the rabbit prince. This story adds a major theme to the film, which is the anxiety of everything around you always wanting to kill you. The film illustrates the rabbits trying to outrun their prey, which starts as man, then as other animals, then as each other. Not only does the film feature many mature themes such as this anxiety, dealing with death and loss, the dangers of fascist leadership, and the deterioration of nature by man, but it also features imagery and moments that are dark and disturbing. This film is often cited as one that traumatized many people who watched it as children upon its release. However, what I find to be most fascinating about this film is the fact that it all derived from a children's book. Richard Adams' Watership Down was considered a classic British literary work before being considered a classic film. The book was taught in schools across the UK and beyond, and many remember reading it as children. This is particularly fascinating to me. The idea that a story so mature in tone and dark in nature could be marketed and considered a children's and family movie and book. Children's media has never necessarily strayed away from dark and mature themes, and in modern day, this has become even more normalized. However, when you watch a film like Watership Down, it's hard to imagine the filmmakers ever had children in mind. The animation is faded and semi-realistic. The voice acting, aside from a few minor characters, is comprised of middle-aged British men speaking in normal voices.
And I told you that I would kill you myself.
There are multiple scenes about rabbits dying or being hurt and cut open. A major plot point in the film consists of the rabbits attempting to take down a corrupt and controlling fascist leader, which results in a bloody battle with rabbits ripping each other open. As mentioned, Watership Down is far from the first quote-unquote children's movie to feature dark and disturbing themes and images. However, I find the time of release of this movie, along with its immediate success, to be an interesting benchmark for children's films. We were about to come face to face with the 80s, colliding with what was, arguably, the most important decade for the fantasy genre, at least when it came to films. Of course, fantasy had been around for generations prior, but it was during the 80s when imagery of knights, dragons, wizards, demons, and magic were at the forefront of film, particularly children's films. So, with children's movies such as Watership Down shaping what the medium of children's films could be, and the boom of the fantasy genre, what we got was a plethora of fantasy films for children which featured dark and disturbing imagery. Imagery that was so profoundly terrifying for children of the era that has been etched in their minds, even today. We live in an age now where information and content for children is infinite, always within reach, and has been shaped and molded by generations of filmmakers, artists, and unfortunately, advertisers. But what if we could try to put ourselves in the mindset of somebody watching one of these films for children in the 80s, when consumption came first and foremost from a television set or a VCR? By taking a deep dive into some of these films, I believe that there's a common theme between them that, while seemingly sinister and evil, is actually very important and profound for children to learn about. That is, teaching children about anxiety and death, two troubling elements in life that are impossible to escape. Themes that films like Watership Down have been trying to bring to an audience of children and families even before the 80s. How did these films illustrate anxiety? And how did these films help children become more accustomed to death? Was all of this disturbing imagery simply to shock and scare children? Or was it merely a reflection of the fears and anxieties that many children already have at this age? Are any of these films truly meaningful or profound? This is Anxiety. I believe a good jumping point from Watership Down to be the 1982 Rankin and Bass film, The Last Unicorn. The film follows a unicorn who is told that she is the last of her kind. She does not believe this to be true, so she sets out to leave her forest and discover where the other unicorns have gone. This film heavily uses the setting and character tropes of popular fantasy media of the time, however, it's not as dark as other children's films of this time period, both in tone and themes, but also literally in color and style. As with most fantasy films, there is a correlation between dark colors and evil, a common theme we will see played out in almost all of these films. However, this film features beautifully illustrated forests, bright fairies, and a majestic pure white unicorn at the forefront, along with the soundtrack recorded by the band America. However, don't let that fool you. This movie does have some underlying darkness, and while not as intense as others we will discuss, it carries ideas and themes comparable in depth to Watership Down. One of the themes introduced early in the movie is about man's mistreatment of animals. Early in the film, the unicorn comes across a witch named Mommy Fortuna, who makes a living by disguising real animals as mythical creatures, keeping them in small cages for people to come and look at. The unicorn can tell these animals aren't mythical at all, revealing the tired old bodies of the animals living beneath the witch's illusions. Mommy Fortuna does face her retribution though, as the only other living real mythical creature, a harpy, is released and proceeds to attack Mommy Fortuna, eating her alive. At least, that's what I got from this scene. There is a constant strain between the relationship of animals and humans in the film. The crux of the story focuses on the unicorn trying to find the Red Bull, an angry creature controlled by King Haggard, which is what he used to get rid of all the unicorns. It's revealed that King Haggard actually saw a unicorn, something that most humans normally cannot do. The king wanted to recapture the magic feeling his whole life, but he could not, so he got the Red Bull to force all the unicorns out into sea, where they can only be seen when the tide rolls in.
Each time I see the unicorns, my unicorns, it is like that morning in the woods, and I am truly young.
So, once again, this idea that animals only exist for the pure entertainment and enjoyment of humans is visited throughout the film. And while not violent, the imagery of animal negligence could easily be challenging for children. Themes of anxiety are weaved throughout the film as well, stated in the title itself. The fear of being the last of anything is a depressing thought, and it's what the protagonist's whole story is based upon. The notion of anxiety leads the film to a discussion on identity in some ways, as when the unicorn is turned into a woman to save her from the Red Bull, she slowly starts to forget who and what she was, truly becoming the last of the unicorns. This unraveling of identity is not a huge focus of the film, but the idea of losing the person you are is something older children may have been able to identify with, navigating relationships and puberty. In more recent years, the film has gained a following for being read as an allegory for gender identity. Regardless of how the film is read, growing up is a very transformative stage, and this transformation could be seen literally in the unicorn. This film doesn't focus on death in particular, but it definitely focuses on loss. While in human form, the unicorn falls in love with the prince. However, in a final battle with the Red Bull, she's turned back into a unicorn, and with the help of the others bobbing in the sea, they're able to defeat him. This seems like a happy ending, until the unicorn realizes that she has to go back to her forest as a unicorn. So, although the story is one of joy, of overcoming anxiety, of accepting identity, it ends on a bitter note, as the unicorn realizes that this is how she will live the rest of her immortal life, in regret.
I have been mortal, and some part of me is mortal yet. I'm no longer like the others, for no unicorn was ever born who could regret, but now I do.
While this movie has many overarching positive and bright themes, I believe it's a good place to start as a fantasy film for children of the 80s that also contained darker themes, such as the abuse of other living things, anxiety, identity issues, and loss. While these are dark ideas, they are issues that are important for children to be aware of, as they inevitably become more prevalent throughout life. Navigating these three things, while also learning empathy for other living things, are all foundational elements of life. Released the same year as The Last Unicorn, Don Bluth's The Secret of NIMH tackles some similar themes and subject matter to the former, however, with much darker tone and aesthetic. The film follows a widowed mouse, Miss Brisby, as she attempts to save her family and move to a new home, while one of her children is too sick to leave the burrow. As one can glean from the synopsis alone, this movie features many mature themes, and the ideas of anxiety and loss are at play in this film as well. As mentioned, the overall aesthetic of the movie is mostly grim and gritty. We meet a great owl who contorts his head, containing glowing yellow eyes. We meet Nicodemus, who, while also being a protagonist, is still an old, decrepit rat with the same glowing eyes. It is in the rats, their home and their character traits, that the darkness in the film truly broods, as skulls, faces in the mud, and green, purple, and red lights create the dark 80s fantasy aesthetic that the film is preoccupied with. However, it is in the rats that the darkness exceeds past the aesthetic, but into the themes and story as well. We learn that the strange word in the title, NIMH, actually stands for the National Institute of Mental Health, a corporation that has, through the process of laboratory tests and unethical injections, transformed these rats into having knowledge and human emotion. Once again, the idea of animal negligence rears its ugly head, as we see rats become injected with a serum that makes them more human. And more than this, it's through the process of becoming human that these rats are more or less tortured, tortured by the knowledge of their lifestyle, of their thievery, and anxiety and danger that guides them as rats, but also tortured by the same follies of man, greed, corruption, and violence. As Nicodemus states,
"We can no longer live as rats. We know too much."
The idea of rats becoming self-aware itself is not that troubling for children, but paired with the aesthetic and violence expressed near the end of the film, it deserves a mention. While not quite as bloody or disturbing as other films on this list, it's the second torture of the rats, the follies of man, that are at the forefront of the climax of the film. An ambitious rat, Jenner, is hungry for power, and decides to destroy the leader, Nicodemus, as well as anyone that stands in his way. This results in a sword fight with a bit of blood, which compared to other films at this time, is pretty tame. However, I think the more disturbing of these violences is Jenner devising a plan in which Nicodemus is crushed to death by a cinder block. While the movie spares us the gory details, it's still abundantly clear that Nicodemus is dead after he's crushed. While not bloody, the idea of the death itself is disturbing and, at the very least, heinous. And it's this disturbing death that leads us into another common theme throughout these movies: loss. While shown to varying degrees throughout these children's fantasy films, there's a clear through line of not only characters having to deal with loss, but having to learn to move on after this loss. Oftentimes, such is the case for this film, this concerns the death of a guiding force or figure. This can be an extremely impactful idea for children in a multitude of ways, the most obvious being illustrating the idea of resilience or perseverance with the loss of a parent or guardian. However, in a more general sense, it's the idea that whatever guides us in our lives, whether that be the magical force of parents, guardians, loved ones, teachers, caretakers, and so on, will not be around forever. This struggle is clearly seen in Miss Brisby, who first loses her husband and then Nicodemus, her guide through this journey. While these themes are adult, it's clear that they can be significant for developing children. The Secret of NIMH draws a correlation between struggles of humans and the struggles of rats, humanizing the animals and telling a story of loss, but also empathy to children. As we stray further into the 80s, we also stray further into the darkness of children's fantasy, with Disney's notorious flop, The Black Cauldron. Releasing in 1985, The Black Cauldron is an adaptation of children's fantasy books, The Chronicles of Brédain by Lloyd Alexander, in which a young and eager child, Taran, attempts to stop an evil horned king from finding the Black Cauldron, a relic that the king can use to summon an infinite army of undead monsters. A lot has been said about this film and its history at Disney, as being in production limbo for years, with an original release date of 1980. Much more grim and sinister than Disney's animated productions before it, its dark and scary tone, lack of recognizable characters or a strong IP, and production issues made this movie a flop before it had even released, making just under half its budget. However, with its dark aesthetic riddled with skulls, demons, and swords, it's gained a somewhat of a cult following from fans who have grown up to appreciate film's aesthetic choices. While the film honestly doesn't have a very strong story or characters like others we will look at, anxiety and death are certainly at the forefront of its drama. The protagonist Taran is being guided on his journey to stop the Horned King by a telekinetic pig, and later, a young woman, a foolish old man, and some creature named Gurgi. The contrast between this colorful, ragtag group of underdogs against the embodiment of pure evil and his army is quite striking. When comparing the Horned King to previous Disney villains in the same era, the Horned King is much more sinister in design, essentially acting as a true devil incarnate. And this evil Horned King also represents the design and tone of the film, where the Black Cauldron is truly a dark fantasy movie. Almost every moment involving the Horned King contains images of dead people, creatures with sharp teeth or glowing eyes, and imagery looking evil in some form. What I find to be even more interesting is that, thanks to the work of some dedicated fans online, it's clear now that the version of the film that we got, which still had an unprecedented PG rating, is a censored and toned down version, with some sequences being animated but never in the film, and some left to never be fully animated. This version has multiple haunting scenes removed, such as a scene where a man is fully disintegrated. While this was never in the movie, I think it's an important note, as it shows where the filmmakers' heads were at during the process of the film. It's clear that from the outset, this film was towing the line of being a children's fantasy film, and the results are clear in the final product. However, amidst all these disturbing scenes of skeletons and zombies, perhaps the most disturbing scene is not the Army of the Dead being raised itself, but during that sequence. In this moment, the annoying and comic relief character Gurgi, who has followed along Taran on this quest, decides that he must sacrifice himself and help save the others, and throw himself into the cauldron. Before he does this, he says,
"Taran has many friends. Gurgi has no friends."
"Gurgi, no! Don't jump! Wait!
What is most troubling about this moment is that besides the later confirmation that Gurgi is indeed dead, there's no follow-up to this moment. There's no lesson about how, for example, Gurgi did have people who loved and cared about him, that his life was worth something. It's the adding of this line right before the sacrifice that adds a whole other layer to this scene. This is a very intense subject to have in a children's movie, and while others have had similar scenes in which a character sacrifices himself, there's normally not a justification to do so. While this film could maybe have handled this moment with a bit more grace, I believe these ideas can open up a conversation or dialogue about these sensitive issues with children, which can have long-term positive benefits. Mental health awareness can be very important for children to understand, and having that tough conversation with children can help them to empathize with other people, or maybe even to be more aware if they have their own struggles in the future, or even if they're struggling now. This scene brings death and loss to the forefront of children's fantasy, which in some ways is more scary and haunting than the Horned King himself. As we continue to dive deeper into these dark and grim fantasy stories of the 80s, we leave behind the medium of animation and come into the live-action sphere. Here, we're met with another 1985 release and another flop from Disney, Return to Oz. I figured it would be like so much of the nostalgia-driven content we've been subjected to in recent years, especially from Disney. However, this is not the case. The film follows Dorothy, who's returned from Oz, her mind ablaze from wonders and magic she had witnessed there. Her aunt, believing this to be a sign of mental illness or hallucinations of some sort, decides to have a doctor administer electroshock therapy. Once again, the idea of mental health comes into play, because the first 20 minutes or so of this film revolve around the dialogue of children's mental health, specifically the lack of autonomy children have around their own mental health, especially at the turn of the 20th century. We see Dorothy strapped to a bed and headphones on her head, all during a dark and stormy night. Dorothy is eventually saved from this machine from a mystery girl and escapes the clutches of these adults, where she floats downstream back to Oz. At this point, it's clear that Dorothy is again going to leave her oppressive and depressing reality and float back into magical Oz where dreams come true. However, this is not the case. When Dorothy returns to Oz, Oz is not the same. Oz is decrepit, in ruins, and most of all, haunting. Instead of being welcomed with open arms into Oz, everything wants to kill her. This is a stark contrast from what's expected of a reboot of an old franchise. While it's common for characters in these films to go back and visit old places and characters, only to find things are not the same, this film completely changes the essence of what Oz is. The original Oz acts as a sanctuary, but also an escape for Dorothy, where she can face down her anxieties and troubles. This Oz is not a sanctuary, but somewhere where she is an intruder. As the story progresses and Dorothy attempts to help the people of Oz, the story does not get much brighter, as she encounters a headless witch who keeps disembodied heads in a cabinet and these absolutely traumatizing things.
Come here, children!
While she does eventually restore order back to Oz, the final battle sequence is dark and sinister as well, evoking images of hell and demons. There's a lot of analysis to be made here, but the main theme of interest I'd like to draw out is that of anxiety. The original Oz, as mentioned, acts as a place for Dorothy to help those that are lacking certain qualities, such as courage, a brain, a heart. However, in helping these characters, Dorothy is in turn helping herself to gain these qualities too, facing down the struggle she's having in the real world. When taking that idea and applying it to Return to Oz, we get a grim sense of the headspace of Dorothy, who feels like since returning from Oz, all the magic in her life's been lost, and those that once guided her want to kill her, or at least, destroy all that remains of her experience in Oz. In both films, by having empathy for others and helping those around them, Dorothy is able to overcome the odds in Oz and live a better life outside of it, which makes a poignant statement about overcoming challenges in life, such as mental health, relationship issues, grief, and loss. That is, that your own life is enhanced when you enhance the lives of others around you. These are very complicated themes that, while children may subconsciously understand, they may not draw out on their own. On a broader scale, the idea of a deteriorating Oz can be made even more dark when drawing a comparison between it and children of a certain age, more so, children of Dorothy's age, right on the cusp of early years of becoming a teenager. It's possible to compare a child's life from when they start making memories until right before being a teenager to Oz. Everything is so light and full of wonder and everything is new. Everything you know wants to protect you and you feel safe. However, as you get older, you start to slowly understand that this is not true, that the world's a dangerous place, and nothing will ever be how it was. This is when Oz begins to crumble and deteriorate around you, and if you let yourself, you can fall into the trap of teenage angst, depression, and this deterioration. In that way, the horrors in this film replicate these intense horrors that children feel at this age, all the while the grim aesthetic carries itself through the entire film. At this age, children should really leave that self-centered view and transition into an empathetic one, and by doing that, it's possible to take that positivity and emotion from Oz into adulthood. Considering the dark tone and this film's commitment to horrific imagery throughout, it's no surprise that children were turned away from this and traumatized by this film. However, with the anxiety of growing up at the forefront, this film has a very real feeling at its core. And these dark themes, soundtrack, aesthetic, and use of impressive practical effects would be in the same realm as the dark and disturbing fantasy created in the 80s by Jim Henson and his team. In 1986, Jim Henson's Labyrinth was released. The film follows a very common idea in children's media, especially in the realm of fantasy, which is that a young person escapes their grim reality and is transported to a magical world in which they must adapt and try to find a way home. Like Return to Oz, Labyrinth is live action, which adds another tactile element to some of the horrific images seen throughout the film, such as the fiery dance and the creature that invades Sarah's room. The film is disturbing in its own right, but much like Return to Oz, the feature of a human helps to ground the viewer. Labyrinth is an example of what a generally playful, while sometimes disturbing, Jim Henson fantasy film for kids can be. However, this is not the film I want to talk about. What if Henson's team were to dive headfirst into dark fantasy, creating a whole world, creatures, and lore? What if this film had themes of evil and a disturbing and grim aesthetic at its forefront? Well, that movie does exist, and it was created 4 years before Labyrinth. Dark Crystal is a result of Jim Henson's love for fantasy and worldbuilding, combined with his creative longing to break away from the Muppets to create something entirely different. While Labyrinth is more similar to the Muppets in character design and overall tone, The Dark Crystal was more or less a complete detour from the work that Henson had done before. The film follows Jin, a creature called a Gelfling, supposedly the last of his kind, who must use the teachings of a mystic that raised him to try and defeat the evil and corrupt Skeksis. The lore for this film is surprisingly very dense, and has only been developing further in recent years with comics and a full Netflix series acting as a prequel to the film. This dense worldbuilding has, for many fans of the franchise, trumped the common criticism of the film's uninspired story. While I don't necessarily fully agree with this criticism, I do believe it's how the film creates this world, and how practical effects, visuals, and performances work together to create this truly disturbing and haunting place, to be the film's most developed quality, again, within a film marketed towards children. Like many films we've discussed, there's a correlation in The Dark Crystal between aesthetic and tone to a character's intentions or morality. This is why the Skeksis are seen in a dark castle, in which they eat grotesque meals, duel one another, and turn on each other. They abuse and prey on other creatures in the land of Thra to power the crystal. It is this power that they use to maintain political control. This idea is very complex. However, what is not as complex is how the film uses haunting imagery to illustrate this idea, such as the infamous podling scene, which many children of the 80s still remember today.
You're very lucky, slave. Only the Emperor can drink your essence.
Although the world of the Dark Crystal may be complicated, children can understand that the Skeksis are evil by the way they torture and prey on innocent creatures, along with the grim aesthetic attributed to them. While not all types of creatures in the film are as haunting as the Skeksis, there are very few characters who have that typical Muppet quality to them, with big eyes and a loving or cartoonish personality. Henson commits to this world entirely, which is the film's biggest barrier of enjoyment. If you love the world, character design, puppets, and aesthetic that Henson's created, you can feel immersed in the story. If you find the world to be too off-putting or disturbing, there's no escaping that feeling. No human or comic relief character to pull you out. Introducing children to a tactile, live-action world in which there's no human to ground them can be disturbing, especially to very young children who struggle to separate this reality. Much like other films we've looked at, the mature themes and tone of the film guide the film's story. Both death and anxiety rear their heads in this film as well, perhaps in different ways than the other films. Death and loss are present with this ongoing trend we see in fantasy films of the 80s, in which a character loses the guiding force in their life and has to try to move on without them. In this case, Jen and the mystic who raised him. Along with this loss, the threat of loss exists in the Skeksis' mission to rule Thra entirely, losing the essence of what Thra is forever. There's also the rampant abuse and tyranny of the Skeksis, which creates an atmosphere of deterioration and evil lurking around corners, adding to the anxiety of the film. So while not as overt as some of the others we've looked at, The Dark Crystal is still ripe with dark themes that are at the core of the film's story. While the imagery alone can traumatize younger children, perhaps the idea, which will scare older children, is the idea that the political structures that exist often gain and remain in power through exploiting the weak and vulnerable, such as the way the Skeksis use the Podlings to literally drain the Podlings' power for their own. As children are leaving Oz, they begin to understand that corruption is rampant in the world, which is a very challenging realization for many children, and which is channeled through films such as this one. While all the films we've looked at today do a great job in world building, creating a tone and aesthetic, it's the dedication and talent of Henson and his team to make a truly immersive and dense world. If it's not obvious, The Dark Crystal is a personal favorite of mine, and you can probably expect a specific video about it in the future. Often, when we look back on our memories of the things we watched as children, we don't necessarily remember the story of what we watched, but how it made us feel. And when you watch The Dark Crystal, you may not like the world it creates, you may be disturbed, you may justifiably critique its narrative elements, but the world being created certainly evokes a feeling of wonder, but also a looming evil. I am not a child psychologist, nor do I have any data to prove anything about any of the movies mentioned in this video or their impact on the audiences that watch them. All I do have is the experience of being a child, and the things that scared me, made me happy, made me laugh, or spoke to me. While there's no way to prove these films did inspire children to think about death or struggles with mental health or empathy for other living things or how hard it is to grow up, if you reflect on your personal experiences, it's hard not to believe that this is the case. We do know that media is influential on children in one way or another, which is why there's been many attempts throughout history to control what children can and cannot engage with. As mentioned at the beginning of this video, as we move forward through the internet era, I believe reflecting on these dark films adds another level of appreciation for the ways in which filmmakers had to maneuver and toe the line of serious topics that they believed were important to their fantasy worlds and important for children to be exposed to. And besides haunting children with nightmares, I truly believe, while I have no evidence to prove so, that the dark fantasy of the 80s helped children understand the experience of real life a little bit more. Regardless of audience, the biggest proof that these dark fantasy films are significant is the staying power that these films have today, with many receiving a cult following. Even the flops have been evaluated and appreciated with time in a different context. Perhaps being subjected to themes of anxiety and death as children is not necessarily a bad thing. At the very least, perhaps children could feel some sense of comfort in knowing that these feelings and experiences are universal. It's clear that the children's fantasy in the 80s was dark, it was terrifying, but also, it was pure magic. Thanks for listening. Take it easy.
Yeah.